Hello. Thanks a lot, Christine, for the introduction. So I'll now show you some federated learning application of healthcare. My goal today is to convince you that healthcare is a nice setting to apply federated learning and that there are lots of nice opportunities there and also some interesting changes in terms of research. My talk will be organized as follows. I will first start with some motivating examples purely on the machine learning applications in healthcare, which are, I think, motivating for the use of federated learning. And then I will show some changes. Okay, so I will start with two motivational examples. The first one is an example of biomarker discovery with machine learning. This is a work that was done by Hawking researchers and medical doctors 2 years ago. So this is a work on mesothelioma, which is a kind of cancer which is caused by asbestos, or amiante in French, which is something which is really used for isolation. And this cancer can be hard to predict its outcome. And so researchers and data scientists have trained a machine learning model which predicts the outcome of the disease given an image of the cancer at diagnosis. And the first good result is that this machine learning model was able to outperform the subtype and grade classification of the pathologist in its ability to separate patients among different risk scores. And this is already great in terms of machine learning, but this is not where the story ends in terms of medicine. Because this machine learning model was then designed to be interpretable, and in particular to point out which region of the image led to either to a high risk or low risk of cancer. And then, thanks to this interpretability, the data scientists were able to show the different subparts of the image to the researchers, which were either very high score or low risk. And by showing these ties to researchers, they have been able to identify some specific patterns of the disease which were not known before, which were associated to lower survival. And this has led to a new subclassification of the disease. So here we have an example of using machine learning to, from data to synthesize new biomedical knowledge. Another example is H2RNA, which is a neural network which was trained on slides, so images of tissues, to predict the gene expression of the tumor. And so this machine learning model was then able to infer the genotype from phenotype information, that is just what is observable from the image. Further, this machine learning model was able to specialize it, because the way the genomic information is computed is just, initially it was just for the whole slide, but it was able to retrieve it spatially. And this is really great because this virtual spatial information maybe help doctors in the future to allocate treatment to patients much more faster than now, because there is no need to undergo a next-gen sequencing of the tumor to know if the tumor will be receptive to immunotherapy. Just with a routine diagnosis, you can know it. And further, in the same fashion as I've shown before, it may be also possible to understand better this cancer and all different kinds of cancer. So these are examples of applications of machine learning in healthcare. So what I want to say is that machine learning opens the possibility to extract information from rich data, in particular from imaging modalities. And this information can be used to accelerate existing workflows by removing, for instance, the need to undergo next-gen sequencing, but also it can lead to the creation of new biomedical knowledge. So this is the motivation of why Hawking is interested in federated learning. Indeed, in order to train a machine learning model, you need to pool data to reach a critical mass. But data is sensitive, in particular for healthcare, there are privacy issues. Also, if you're talking about data that has been amassed by pharmaceutical companies, it is very competitive. There are also some costs and complexity of transferring data, and there are increasing regulations to monitor such transfers. And therefore, data remains in silos. which leads to a lack of diversity and representativity, because for instance, if you have only data from a hospital in Nantes, then it has only seen patients from Nantes with its environmental factors, and it has not seen much more variability. And in some cases, for instance, for rare diseases, there is no center which holds enough data just to train machine learning model. And this is where machine learning comes in. Machine learning, federated learning opens the possibility to perform collaboration without sharing data in a secure, compliant, and collaborative fashion. And to unlock federated learning, Hawking has started to build a data network of partner institutions with top researchers in each medical domain, with data from different modalities, including genomic, imaging, histopathology. And it's also building its own federated learning technology under the name Hawking Connect, which is able to connect these different centers to enable federated learning at scale. So this is the general picture. I will now show two examples of applications, of real-world applications of federated learning that are ongoing now. The first one is called Melody. This is a pilot project with 10 different pharmaceutical companies. The goal is to perform, to train a model for drug discovery tasks. So each pharmaceutical company has amassed some data on on different chemical compounds, and they have done some assays measuring the chemical properties. And for instance, the way they bind to potential target. And this is really great, but each pharma may have focused on a different target area, and it would be great if we could pool all these data sets. However, we're really here in what we call the competitive framework, so it's we would like to collaborate among competitors. In particular, no pharmaceutical company wants the other pharmaceutical companies to know on which chemicals it has worked, because it represents a lot of sensitive information on where its next drugs are going to be. And this is really important in terms of its business strategy. And so here we are training a machine learning model with a multitask formulation. So there is a shared representation which is trained in a federated learning fashion, and then there is this is deep learning, and there are all the layers which are refined on each center. And real-world deployment is ongoing, and we may share results in the future. Another application that is going on is HealthChain, in particular for triple-negative breast cancer. So triple-negative breast cancer is kind of rare cancer affecting women, mostly. And for this cancer, there is most patients mostly undergo, following diagnosis, a neoadjuvant chemotherapy just to reduce the size of the tumor, and then to undergo surgery to remove the tumor. And unfortunately, in some cases, patients have not responded to the chemotherapy and realize at surgery that response was either complete or not complete. And this is a pity, because patients have to undergo a very toxic chemotherapy, and they may not respond. And predicting this response is complicated even for very experienced doctors. And the goal of this project was to train a machine learning model to predict the response to chemotherapy from the diagnosis biopsy, so really the image of the cancer. And so we have set up a collaboration between Institut Curie and Centre Léon-Bérard, where in each center you have images of the tumor and the histopathological response after the undergoing chemotherapy. And the goal is to predict. So this is a pilot project which is partly funded by BPI France, and there is real-world deployment ongoing also for this project. I'd like to point out this for this project, there are two changes. The first is that already it was not known before that machine learning could help for this task, and we're also carrying it out with federated learning, because it's kind of a rare disease, and thanks to this, we're able to access a larger cohort. Okay, so these were some examples of what we do at Hawking in terms of federated learning applications. Now I will present some challenges that we face in applying these technologies. So the first challenge is non-technical, and it's really important. We had a great talk previously on the legal aspects, and in fact, yes, data regulations are important. In particular, it's important that everybody agrees on the same understanding of the law, since it's quite new. And also, if you want to set up international collaborations, it's important to have a common framework. Another very important challenge is contracting, because there are lots of different stakeholders in making this kind of consortia. There is a hospital. Within the hospital, there are the doctors, the IT. Then maybe you have a cloud provider, and maybe you have Booking, and maybe you have third parties. And you need everybody to agree on their roles, their responsibilities. In particular, you need to agree on value sharing, because the resulting consortium will lead to a machine learning model which may have a lot of value in itself. For instance, in the drug discovery example that I was showing before, the machine learning model may lead to finding better drugs in the future, so it has a lot of value. How do we split it? This is a question, and it needs to be solved and to be discussed and negotiated. Now, in terms of technical challenges, I think we've seen most of them already today, and I won't go into the details, but there is a change of privacy and confidentiality, because yes, data never leaves centers with federated learning, but there are indirect exchanges of weights, of updates, and therefore there could be indirect privacy and confidentiality leaks. And I think there's still a lot of work to be done to improve the privacy utility trade-off in this direction. Another challenge that we face is simply to distribute some machine learning models. Because as we've seen today, the standard federated learning problem formulation is to minimize loss function, which is a sum of individual losses for each center, and typically the loss for a center is an empirical risk for given samples. And this is great, in particular for deep learning, it works great. But there are two independent assumptions. The first is that the loss is separable across samples and centers, and also that parameters belong to a vector space, which makes it possible to perform gradient methods, and the notion of weight averaging makes sense. Now, what do you do when you want to train a machine learning model which does not respect these assumptions? For instance, the assumption of separability. In deep learning, what is really useful to get to a good performance is the batch normalization layer, but it's really non-separable. How do we do? There has been some work, especially last year, to try to understand what we do, what can be done, and typically it's just a layer which is left out and not federated. Another problem that we face is that since we're interested in biomedical applications, we use a lot of survival analysis and this model called Cox proportional hazard. And when you look at the loss function, it's also non-separable. And what do you do in this case? Do you make proxies for the loss, or do you try still to compute the full loss? It's not trivial. And a last question, and really open, is how do you do when the parameters do not belong to a vector space, in particular for tree-based models, which are getting the best performance, in particular when you're using tabular data? This is a challenge that we face. The last challenge that we face is data heterogeneity. These are examples of images that are that were really created at different hospitals, and due to the varying chemical compounds that were used to stain the slides, it led to slightly different colors. You really see it when you look at the histogram, and this is just for the visible part. But in fact, you can have much more factors of variability, such as demographics, the techniques that were used to prepare the data, and the way the cohort was built, because we're using retrospective cohorts, and they may have been for some purposes. And this, as we've seen today, this can lead to a lot of issues, it can lead to statistical biases. So the question is, how do we formalize this heterogeneity? We've seen some answer today, because heterogeneity is way too large. We need to define subtypes of heterogeneity and define adaptive method for each subtype, and ideally we need to find methods to automatically detect and adjust to these settings so as to be able to work in the federated learning setting. And the last challenge is to integrate all constraints, because we have the privacy constraint, we have the heterogeneity constraint, for instance. And if you have a lot of heterogeneity, maybe you want to communicate much more often, for instance. But then, is it compatible with your privacy budget? And if you want to distribute some fancy machine learning model, you set up a novel algorithm to do so, is it private? And this is, I think, what federated learning is about. It's about integrating all these constraints into a single thing that works. So to conclude, I think machine learning has a lot of opportunities to accelerate medical research. And federated learning is a great tool to break silos and to enable collaborations. And this setting in particular of healthcare presents a lot of exciting challenges and research topics. Thanks for your attention.
So, thank you very much, Mathieu, for your talk. We have two minutes for maybe one or two questions, either for Mathieu or for Laetitia. No? Ah, okay.
If I really understand it right from you, aucune value added is the ability to gather a large number of data from competitors who would dare to share it for its treatment with the basis of an independent, confidential intermediary. That means you can get the data, you can treat it properly with professional skills, and restitute to the owner without the danger that this data sharing would be falling, the origin of the data would be falling on the end of a competitor. You have a kind of SAS to speak about a submarine. And this is where the need for you to exist is a very strong value for the economy. Is it right? So
we're not sharing data. We really, data stays where it was, either in the pharmaceutical centers or in the hospitals. And we simply access it to train a machine learning model. And only the model itself sees the data.
To speak about the preceding one, the lady. Actually, what was a very strong value about what he explained is that the new economical model that would be needed for the future would be model in which each new brick to add value, to add expertise, competence, would be remunerated, would be paid on a fair value, and according to that, the question to Ms. Led, please, would be, please, are according to you, in this economic model of fair value for each participants of value creation, would need, including the consulting firms, the people who provide strategical advice, would be part of this revenue sharing model where they would be remunerated according to the value they bring to their client's company. That means McKinsey, Boston Consulting Group, your company, would in the future be paid not as providing means, but as results, as a share, a fair share of the value they provide.
Thank you for your question. So, the point that you mentioned is very important indeed, because you are talking here about how in an ecosystem, in a shared economy, actually every party, every participant is getting benefits of actually either providing services in that one. So I would say that usually when a party or company or an individual participate in an ecosystem, that's most of the time, of course, because he finds his interest. So, the companies that you, some of those that you mentioned there, which are kind of providing technology, also have their role to play in that shirt. So they provide the technology, which is something that is actually not possible for any individuals to create. So those companies provide the platform. So this is one thing also variable for all. And people, then individuals, are using those platforms to share services, to exchange services and value. The fact that the revenues are not all the time equally shared is just a matter of how the ecosystem, the governance of the ecosystem. And this is something that will tend, of course, to be balanced. And I think that as every individual we have the opportunity to participate or to not participate to an ecosystem, we also let him the chance to a kind of evaluate the return on investment that it gets from that ecosystem. Thank you.
Okay, so I thank you to I propose to thank you our both speakers, and now